Hello friends, the topic for today is retinoblastoma. So we all know that retinoblastoma is the most common primary malignant intraocular tumor in children. Okay, so please look at the terms again. It's a primary, it's a malignant and intraocular tumor in children. Now the incidence is not very high. You must know that almost 3% of all malignancies in children are retinoblastomas. Okay, so almost 3% of all malignancies in child is retinoblastomas. Now what happens? Let's talk about the genetics in retinoblastoma. So this is one tumor which has involvement of tumor suppressor gene. Okay, so this is one tumor where you have tumor suppressor gene in the form of a retinoblastoma gene. Now this tumor suppressor gene undergoes mutation. That is why you have retinoblastomas. Now this is the tumor which follows a Knudsen's two hit hypothesis. It follows Knudsen's two hit hypothesis. So Knudsen's two hit hypothesis says that you should have mutations two times. You should have mutation twice in a normal retinal cell to become a malignant cell. Okay, so it follows Knudsen's two hit hypothesis, which says that in a normal retinal cell to become a malignant you should have a mutation twice. Now let's see what retinoblastoma gene has to do. Retinoblastoma gene is a tumor suppressor gene which is present over the long arm of 14th band of the 13th chromosome. So this is your 13th chromosome long arm and 14th is the band. So there undergoes a mutation in this gene twice. Now let's understand what happens when there is a hereditary tumor and what happens when there is a sporadic tumor, non-hereditary or sporadic tumor. Now hereditary tumors are not common, not much common, just 40% are hereditary. Sporadic are most common, these are 60%, non-hereditary are 60%. Now hereditary means that you have mutation in the germline cells, and this mutation is the first mutation. So hereditary means that those tumors which have a mutation in the germ cells as the first mutation. So the second hit, the second mutation or the second hit will be in the retinal cell. It will be in the retinal cell. Now friends, if the problem is in germ cell, that means that all cells of the body will be affected. All cells are affected. That is why patients who have hereditary tumors, they are prone to have other cancers, isn't it? They are prone to have other cancers, because the mutation has occurred in them in germ cells. And that is why when they present to us, they present earlier. Okay, so early presentation, because first mutation has already occurred in them. It is the first hit already present in them. So this is the special thing about the hereditary tumors. They patients are prone to have other cancers, they have earlier presentation as compared to the non-hereditary tumors. Now what are the other cancers which patient can have apart from retinoblastomas? Most common they have is the penealoblastoma, pineal tumors. Okay, pineal tumors are the most common. You can also have osteosarcomas. You can have other small cell tumors and you can have neuroblastomas and so on, but the most common being penealoblastoma. But if they ask you what is the most common extracranial tumor with retinoblastoma, then you have to mention osteosarcoma, that this is the most common extracranial tumor with retinoblastoma. Now, there is a term which is called as a trilateral retinoblastoma. Let's see what this is. So, trilateral retinoblastoma means a bilateral retinoblastoma with a pineal tumor. Now, there's one more term which is quadrilateral retinoblastoma. Now, quadrilateral retinoblastoma means a trilateral plus pituitary tumors. So, these two things also should be known, a trilateral retinoblastomas and a quadrilateral retinoblastomas. Now, hereditary tumors can be further divided into familial tumors or non-familial tumors. They can be further divided into familial tumors or non-familial tumors. Familials are very less. They are just 7 to 10% and rest of them are non-familial. Now, familial means that they are going to transfer this to the family members and they have inherited from the parents, okay? Familial means that they are inherited from the parents and they are going to transmit it to the offsprings also, okay? So, this is your familial tumors. Now, friends, let's see again. Familial tumors are very less, just 7 to 10%. Don't confuse them from the hereditary. Hereditary are almost 40%. So, stick to the terms familial and hereditary, what I have told you. Now, let's talk about the clinical features and the spread. So, a retinoblastoma can be seen as an endophytic tumor or it can be seen as a endoexophytic tumor. Now, endophytic means that it grows inside the retina or grows into the vitreous cavity. Now, exophytic means that from the retina it comes out and can spread to the choroid and sclera. Okay, so choroidal spread, scleral spread or extrascleral spread is also exophytic tumor. Now, the main complaint of the patients of retinoblastoma is usually a leukochoria. Leukochoria. So, a mother will come to you with complaints of an abnormal white reflex in the child's eye. So, what is leukochoria? An abnormal white reflex in the eye. And this can be your picture question also. Now, apart from retinoblastoma, there are other causes of leukochoria as well. So, what are the other differential diagnoses of leukochoria? You can have this in PHPV, Coats disease, toxocariasis, endophthalmitis, retinal detachments, Norrie's disease, congenital cataract, and coloboma. So, these are the differential diagnoses of a patient with leukochoria. So, that's how leukochoria will look like. So, you see an abnormal white pupillary reflex. Now, other presentations apart from leukochoria can be squint. The child with retinoblastoma can also present with squint, which is most commonly a esotropia. The child can also have endophthalmitis. He can also present with a congenital cataract, which is a complicated cataract. There can be a uveitis. There can be a proptosis as well. So, you can have various presentations of retinoblastoma. Now, the most common age of presentation is usually 18 months. But as I told you again, that bilateral tumors have earlier presentations and unilateral tumors have mostly late presentations. Now, as we know that retinoblastoma is a malignant tumor, so it can spread, of course. And the most common method of spread is through the direct route by the optic nerve. So, the optic nerve is going to brain. So, there will be a direct spread of the tumor from the retina to the brain. Now, how do you diagnose? So, diagnosis is mainly first by doing examination under anesthesia. You can do examination under anesthesia of a child and you can look at the mass in the retina. So, it can appear as a dome-shaped mass, Sometimes you can have associated exudative retinal detachment also, okay? So, you will see that there is a dome-shaped mass. Now, how will you make sure that this dome-shaped mass is a retinoblastoma? So, this can be assured once you do a ultrasound B scan. So, when you do a B scan and you see a mass associated with calcification. So, this calcification is pathognomic for retinoblastoma. So, this calcification in a mass is pathognomic for retinoblastoma. So, again you can have a picture question here where you see a ultrasound B scan of retinoblastoma. Here you have a mass associated with calcification. So, this calcium deposition tells you that there is a retinoblastoma. Now, when you are suspecting that already your optic nerve is affected, so you to check out the optic nerve involvement, you have to do a MRI. So, for optic nerve involvement, you have to do a MRI. This is the best to check for the optic nerve status. Now, once you do a enucleation, sometimes we have to do a enucleation in advanced cases. Once you do a enucleation, then you will do a histopath. And on histopath, in the enucleated eye only, once you see a Flexner-Winter-Steiner rosette. Okay, so once you see a Flexner-Winter-Steiner rosette, again this is pathognomic for retinoblastoma. Now, what is this Flexner-Winter-Steiner rosette? You have them as aggregations around a central lumen. So, if you see the central lumen is there and you have arrangement of cells with the nucleus displaced peripheral. So, if you see these are the arrangement of cells and the nucleus are displaced peripherally. This is characteristic of Flexner-Winter-Steiner rosettes. Now, apart from these rosettes, you can also see pseudo rosettes. You can also have Homer-Wright rosettes. You can also have fluorettes. So, these are four types of rosettes which you can see in patients of retinoblastoma, but characteristics are Flexner-Winter-Steiner rosette, which are pathognomic. Now, friends, various classification systems has been advised in case of retinoblastomas where you have a grouping, where you have staging. But the most promising, the most advanced classification system is the International Classification of Retinoblastoma, which has a grouping system, as you can see here, a grouping system, and which also has a staging system. Okay. Now, please understand what is this grouping and staging. Now, grouping means that what is the prognosis of salvageable part of the vision, how much vision you can save, how much eye can be saved. Okay, so this tells you about the prognosis of safe vision and your eye safety. Now, it tells that if you have a small tumor which is less than 3 and which you have a small tumor with minimal spread, this you can have in group A, B and C. But when you have a large tumor with extensive spread, you will have this in group D and E. So friends, you should not go into details of each and everything in the grouping and staging. What I am telling you is important, that grouping tells you about the prognosis of the vision, how much you can save in the eye. When you have A, B and C group, this means that you have a localized disease, not much advanced disease. Now, second is the staging. So, staging tells you about the prognosis of the life. Okay. So, once you have done a enucleation, then the probability of saving the life of an individual is considered under the staging. Okay. So, the survival of the patient is depicted in staging. Now, friends, here stage 0 is when you have not enucleated, and rest of the stages is after the enucleation, that if the tumor is completely resected, how much is the prognosis that you can save the baby? And here, very grim chances when you have stage 4 disease, the stage disease is already having a spread. Okay, so this is your grouping and staging. Now, when we treat these babies, the first aim is to save the life of the child. Save the child first. Then comes the safety of the eye. And last comes the safety of the vision. Okay. So, the first primary aim is that we should save the life of the child. Now, the treatment modalities are many. Okay. So, the treatment modalities are many. First is we can treat. First is that we can treat a small tumor which is unilateral, small or less advanced tumor with minimal spread. That means mainly you have group A, B and C. Mainly you have group A, B and C. Here the modalities of treatment mainly is an intravenous chemotherapy. Now, apart from them, there is a recent trend that you can give intravitreal chemo. There is a trend that you can also give intraarterial chemo. And you can also give the focal therapies. You can also give the focal treatments. Now, what is the meaning of focal treatment? Focal means that you are targeting the tumor cells only. You want to cut the blood supply, you want to cut the vascularity of the tumor so that the small tumors, they will regress on their own. Now, the focal treatment could be in the form of cryotherapy, that you apply cryo probe from the external sclera where your tumor is located and your vascularity can be cut short. Other modality of treatment is through lasers. You can apply laser photocoagulation from inside, so that your vascularity is damaged. Now, other modality of treatment is external beam radiotherapy, the plaque therapy, where you can put a radioisotope externally through the sclera and then radiation is given so that the tumor cells are damaged on their own. Now, intravitreal and intraarterial chemotherapy is mainly given by melphalan. This is nowadays the drug of choice for intravitreal chemo and intraarterial chemo. There is a problem with this intravitreal and intraarterial chemo, that the vitreous seeds, they do not respond very much to such a treatment. So here we can plan to give intravenous chemotherapy and the regimen is VEC. So VEC means vincristine, etoposide and carboplatin. Okay, so these are the agents which you can use to treat a primary tumor, a small, less advanced unilateral tumor with a limited spread. Now, the second is when you have unilateral advanced tumor. Now, unilateral advanced tumor is that you have a tumor which is almost covering more than half of the vitreous cavity, or you have an advanced tumor where it is causing a neovascular glaucoma, you have invasion of the tumor cells in the interior segment also, when there is hardly any chance of salvaging the eye of the patient. So you may have it in D and E groups. The treatment mainly resides in enucleation. So it is better to take off the eye. Do a complete enucleation along with a part of the optic nerve. So the basic idea here is that we cannot save the eye of the patient, but let's save the life of the child. Okay, so do a enucleation. Now you can also give chemotherapy here. You can also give intravenous chemotherapy before you do a enucleation, and this is called as neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy means that you first give few cycles of chemo so that your tumor cell, it will shrink. Okay, the tumor cells will shrink, and then you do a enucleation. So you do a better enucleation. There will be a limited chance of the spread after you do a enucleation. Now this is the enucleated specimen of the eyeball. Okay, so have you seen that this is your enucleated specimen with a section of the optic nerve? You have completely resected. Totally the globe is out with a part of the optic nerve. Now friends, here in tumors, when we do a complete enucleation of the tumors, we make sure that the longest possible section of the optic nerve should be taken out of the globe, and the remaining stump in the eyeball should be free from tumor cells. Okay, so the remaining stump should be free from the tumor cells. That is why it is said that when you do an enucleation, more than 10 mm should be resected with the eyeball. The basic idea is that the remaining stump in the eye should be free from the tumor cell so that it doesn't spread and now go to the brain. Okay, so this was enucleation in unilateral advanced tumors. Now if you talk about the bilateral tumors, the mainstay of treatment is intravenous chemotherapy. You can also give radiation therapy, but chemotherapy is the main stage. So that's all about retinoblastoma. Thank you very much.